A warm welcome from me, Helen Charlton, to this online worship today from the benefice of Ruscombe, Twyford and Hurst with the URC. A warm welcome to everybody who's joining us, whether you're a normal church member or whether you've just happened to tune in. This is the final of three pre-recorded services, which are covering a period where we were a bit thin on the ground with some of our key people. And as such, it's quite difficult to know exactly what things are going to be like on the 9th of August when I'm sitting here at the end of July in my study. But we do pray as a ministry team for all of you, wherever you are, whatever's going on in your life. And we start, as usual, with a lighted candle to remember that Jesus is the light of the world and is with us all the time. And that's why we always light a candle at the beginning of every service when we're meeting in the flesh. So our theme today is taken from the gospel reading, which is Jesus and Peter, both walking on water with varying degrees of success. And Anna will be preaching using that and our other reading later on. So we're just going to start with the shortened version of the collect, which is the special prayer for today, and we say together, gracious Father, revive your church in our day. Make her holy and strong and faithful for your glory's sake. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And I'm now going to hand over to our musicians for the opening worship.
First reading is from Romans chapter 10, verses 5 to 15. Moses writes this about the righteousness that is by the law. The person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that is by faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down, or who will descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, it is in your mouth and in your heart. That is, the message concerning faith that we proclaim. If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. As Scripture says, anyone who believes in him will never be put to shame. For there is no difference between Jew and Gentile. The same Lord is Lord of all, and richly blesses all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. How then can they call on the one that they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? And how can anyone preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is taken from Matthew chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. Jesus walks on the water. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they cried, and cried out with fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I, do not be afraid. Lord, it is you, Peter replied. Tell me to come to you on the water. Come, he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and beginning to sink, cried out, Lord, save me. Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. You of little faith, he said, why did you doubt? And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. And those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, everybody, and it's really good to have you with us this morning. For this morning's reflection, I'd like to concentrate just very briefly, because it is light with the summer holidays, on the theme of prayer and how and where and how we join together in prayer. But let's begin with a contemplation on prayer with an act of prayer. So let's just bow our heads for a moment. Loving God, as we take a moment to consider the wonderful gift of our prayer life, we thank you that the Lord Jesus taught us how to pray. So guide us this morning in our reflection. And may I speak in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. How is your prayer life? For clergy, we're encouraged to meet on a regular basis with somebody called a spiritual director. A good practice to be in for anybody in ministry, lay or ordained. And one of the questions your spiritual director tends to ask you in the first instance is, how are you doing with your prayer life? Sounds like a simple question, but it's a profound question. And particularly if you're a ministry on a full-time or any sort of ministry, just for a few hours a week, however you're engaged in the life of the church. The reason it's so important and the reason our bishops place so much emphasis on the prayer life of the of particularly the ordained person is that prayer is seen as the fountain of life, the sustainer of ministry. When we forget to pray, we don't grow. When we forget to pray, we're not listening and we're not sustained by Jesus as the source of our ministry. There's a danger of being led by the ego rather than being led by God as the source of life. It's a simple question, but with profound meaning. So how is your prayer life? You might like to go away and think about that later in the day, today or during the week. How has your prayer life been during this time of lockdown? And what does prayer mean to you? Or does it mean anything at all? How's this time of lockdown affected your spiritual journey? I've been listening to the Bishop of Oxford's Reflections for a Church in Lockdown, which I highly commend to you as being really helpful times of prayer and reflection. They're only a few minutes, but well worth sitting down and taking time to consider. And he's talked in great detail about the effects of this situation on the life of the church and us as individual believers. And he talks about how lockdown may have affected your spiritual journey. And it's caused me to reflect also. The time of lockdown has been a challenging and difficult time for the life of the church. We've been physically separated. We've had to look at new ways and means of being connected with one another. We've all become far more proficient in the use of Zoom and being able to look at ourselves on cameras. But what's been the spiritual dimension of this time of lockdown? I do wonder, there's been many things we've lost, but also things we've gained. And together with Bishop Steve and I was caused to reflect on maybe this time taking us back to our roots and the basis of our Christian discipleship. Fellowship is really important with other believers, and sharing worship is critical at the heart of who we are. But when we can't physically meet together, or when we do begin to meet together, it'll be smaller and perhaps more intimate. The first Christian believers didn't have the structure of church around them quite like we do. And they were taken back and they were working right from a grassroots level. The simplicity of the first believers just forming together as the body of Christ based on their encounter with Jesus Christ. It's very profound, and maybe that's where this will take us. There's no doubt we're all missing the value of Christian companionship within the church, but maybe this moves us back to our foundations and the very roots of our faith. Have you been able to pray without engaging in collective worship in the physical sense? Our passage today in Matthew 13, and particularly 14, I want to focus on the verse where Jesus, after he dismissed the crowds, went up the mountain by himself to pray. He went up the mountain by himself to pray. Previously, he'd been surrounded by many people and many crowds. It shows his humanity. Like so many of us, when you feel overwhelmed by being surrounded by lots of people or demands on your time or energy, you need time to go away and to refuel. He'd been giving out a great deal of himself, no doubt, by listening and healing and spending time with people. So it's so human to want to go and spend time alone. And that's what he did. He needed to be resourced and ready to go forward into the ministry that he knew would claim so much in his life. And I've no doubt that he did this many times. This is just an episode that's recorded in Matthew 14. He withdrew to pray and to spend time with his Father, the one who he knew would sustain him for the way ahead. So Jesus went by himself to pray. I quite often get asked by children or people in the congregation or in our wider community, well, how do I pray? I don't think I've quite got it right. I don't use big enough words, or I'm not quite equipped. I don't think there's a formula for prayer, but rather it's based on relationship. Prayer can be silent. Many find just a time of silence, just listening to God and knowing that God is listening to them is a helpful way to pray. It can be out loud and boisterous and loud, the praises of children in prayer, particularly moving and energetic and enthusiastic. It can be said or thought, words said out loud, ancient words repeated as we do in the liturgy and ways of the Church of England. Or it can be just thought in the head. Some people find prayer in a sacred place particularly profound, either sat in a churchyard, in the sun on a bench, or sat in pews of an ancient place of worship such as St. James or St. Nicholas. But others find prayer in a lively and exuberant context just as helpful. Prayer can be outdoors or at home. Some people find being still helpful in their prayer life, finding a quiet place to still the body, the mind, and the soul. I like to pray as I walk. I find the stimulation of the physicalness of walking and thinking and praying really helpful. There's no formula. Again, it's about relationship with God. Some people find prayer helpful alone, and we all need to be able to pray alone. If we claim that we are a disciple of Jesus Christ, we are instructed to pray. But prayer with others is moving and wonderful and deep and profound. Prayer can be complex or simple, creative, and sometimes prayer is urgent. I've been in many churches where we've gathered in prayer at times when we've known that a member of our community really needs that intense time of prayer for their spiritual or physical needs. But like Jesus, prayer is grounded in our relationship with God. Relationships, as with human relationships, vary in depth. God loves each one of us, no matter who we are, and longs to hear the voice of the created. To the depth of our creation, our connection will be different and at different times of life. And prayer is always centered in love. Jesus longs to hear our voices as we long to hear his voice. It's a conversation with God, and like Jesus, we're drawing to allow ourselves to be in God's presence. It needs space and time. Time sometimes can be quite an issue for so many of us. But I would commend to you making prayer a priority sometimes and switching off my phone. I'm going to a quiet place for a few minutes just to pray. I don't say that glibly. I know easier said than done in busy lives, especially with small children. But it's making a priority and a focus. Seeing our prayer life as something that sustains us and sustains others and our world. Of course, prayer for many reasons. You know, we bring that shopping list to God sometimes of things and people we're concerned about, and that's okay. But sometimes it's really good to start your prayer journey that day with thanksgiving. How often do we say, do you know what, today my prayers are just going to be about thanks? And even sometimes in the hardest of times, when we're enduring pain or discomfort, or we know others around us that we love are suffering, why not try to start with a place of thanksgiving to God? Thanksgiving is critical in the life of prayer. And then praise for all God has done for us in Jesus and the beauty of creation and the world that we live in. An important aspect of the life of prayer for the believer also is penitence. How often do we pray a prayer of confession while we've not been in church over the last few months? It is important to come before God and to seek that forgiveness, that we need renewal on a daily basis for the choices that we make. And prayer is about seeking. As with last week when we talked about the pearl of great price, prayer is about seeking God and seeing where God is at work. There's lots of helpful books on prayers in the Christian community. I've been reading one by a lady called Sue Pickering. It's called Listening and Spiritual Conversation. There are many on the market, and I think you need to find something that suits you. She writes some helpful things about the life of prayer. She writes that when we pray, we talk to God about our desire to be more aware of what God is doing in each and every day. We need to practice listening prayer so our still centre is sustained and we are open to the Spirit of God. We take the time to pray when something catches our attention. We contemplate, slow down, and pause long enough to let God speak to us through the ordinary things of life. We take the incarnation seriously. We look for signs of movement toward Christ's likeness in our lives, styles, and priorities. We can recognize that we indeed need the presence of Christ for others, and we give thanks for the privilege of this reality. When others help us in prayer, we can recognize God in their voice and in their care for us. In prayer, we can become aware of the presence of Jesus where there is love or suffering. For where love and kindness abound, God is truly there. Where suffering and grief abound, God is truly there. Prayer is about noticing God at work in our world. Prayer needs priority and perseverance. We are to persevere in our prayers. I do know people that have the gift of perseverance in prayer. When they say they will pray for you, they really do mean it. And that truly is a treasure of the kingdom. Never say, all I can do is pray for you, for prayer is profound and deep and meaningful. Julian of Norwich writes about perseverance in prayer. Our prayer brings great joy and gladness to our Lord. He waits it and welcomes it. By his grace, he can make us like him and condition as we are by creation. This is his will. So Jesus says, pray inwardly, even though you find no joy in it, for it does good, though you feel nothing, see nothing. Yes, even you think you cannot pray. For when you are dry and empty, sick and weak, your prayers please me. Though they be little enough to please me, all believing prayer is precious to me. God accepts the good will and work of his servants in prayer, no matter how we are feeling. So I encourage you during this time of lockdown, why not take some time to think about your prayer journey and your prayer life? Maybe recommit to a life of prayer and time for prayer. Jesus definitely used prayer as a means of sustaining himself and his ministry, and that applies to us too. The life of the Christian believer should be rich in the gift of prayer. And prayer changes our world. We can pray for others, we can pray for our world, we pray for ourselves, we pray for those we love and those we find hard to love. We pray for forgiveness and healing, compassion and strength. So I urge you to reconsider your prayer life, to recommit to finding a deeper way to pray. Try not to compare yourself to others, for your relationship with God is yours alone. And will be profoundly used if you just open your heart to his ways and his voice. I thought I'd end this talk, this brief reflection this morning, the very famous prayer. It's a prayer of St. Patrick's breastplate, but it is ancient. It is one of the said prayers that people find helpful. But don't get me wrong, I'm not commending the only way to pray is using words, for there are truly many, many ways, which if we are open, we can hear and know God's voice. So a prayer to end with. Christ be with you, Christ within you, Christ behind you, Christ before you, Christ beside you and Christ to win you, Christ to comfort and restore you, Christ beneath you and Christ above you, Christ in quiet times, Christ in danger, Christ in hearts of all that love you, and Christ in the mouth of friend and stranger. And may you rise this day through the strength of heaven, the light of the sun, the brilliance of the moon, the splendour of fire, the swiftness of wind and the depth of the sea, the stability of earth, may you rise through strength of heaven and know that you are home. May you rise this day through God's strength piloting you, God's might upholding you, God's wisdom guiding you, God's ear to look, eye to look before you, and God's ear to hear you, God's word to speak to you, God's hand to guard you, God's way to lie before you, and God's shield to protect you, and God's host to secure you. Amen.
For our prayers today, I'm basing them on some intercessions by David Adam, who is a Celtic author, and they're based on our gospel reading of the storms of life. Lord, in the storms of life, bid us come to you, that we who are aware of our weakness may be made strong through the power of Christ. When we are in danger of being overwhelmed, increase our faith. When troubles beset us, let us hear you say, "Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid." Give to our church and the church all over the world a new vision of yourself and your saving power. Help us to grasp these opportunities to reach out to all our communities through the new links that we may have found during this crisis. Go with us as we go out to proclaim your love. We pray for areas where the church is struggling or being overwhelmed, for all evangelists and pastors who are overworked or in danger. And we pray for all who reach out in faith towards you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for areas of the world where there have been floods or natural disasters, those areas that are worst affected by COVID, and for all of us who may be affected by the economic consequences of what's happening. We pray for all who are swamped by poverty or hunger, for all who are battered by wave after wave of oppression or violence, for those who have no freedom, for all who are sinking beneath a load of care and anxiety. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for all those who have supported us in our times of trouble or distress. And we pray for friends who are in need at this time. We pray that we will be a strength rather than a burden on others. We remember all who are finding caring for their home overwhelming. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for all who are down, the fearful, the weary, the despairing. We pray for all who are unable to help themselves. And we remember all who give a helping hand, whether it's a neighbourly act, carers, care workers, NHS workers. And we remember all who are suffering in the care of another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for those who are beyond the storms of this world and have come to the haven of rest. Though our faith is weak, we reach out to you, for you are the Almighty. Grant that we may come to be with your saints in life eternal. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. and we join in the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Big thank you to everybody who participated in today's service and made it possible. And we're going to close with a poem come prayer that I found from the Wild Goose Worship book, which is part of the Iona community, and they have an amazing selection of Celtic style prayers. And this has a little refrain, which is "Thanks be to God," if you want to join in. For all that God can do within us, and for all that God can do without us, thanks be to God. For all in whom Christ lived before us, for all in whom Christ lives beside us, thanks be to God. For all the Spirit wants to bring us, for where the Spirit wants to send us, thanks be to God. Listen. Christ has promised to be with us in the world as in our worship. Amen. We go to serve him. And I'll conclude with the blessing. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and those you love, now and always. Amen.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright, who will bear my light to them, whom shall I save?
Set a feast for them, my hand will save.